Good evening, everyone. My name is Yanine Jamaluddin from Lebanon, and I will be your host for today. I'm very happy to have you all with us today as a part of this second webinar. Webinars are a main part of ChallengeME competition, and the best thing about them is that you can attend from anywhere you are. So what we're going to discuss in today's webinar. The aim of today's webinar is to introduce the ChallengeME competition and the Internet of Things, IoT. We will be talking about the challenge, explaining the challenge key milestones and ChallengeME judging criteria, highlighting the IoT judging criteria in the competition. Moreover, Mr. Poor from Intel will join us to give you guys an overview of IoT, what is IoT, and what are the different IoT fields, as well as he will talk about the IoT boards. At the end of the webinar, we will be happy to answer all your questions. So let's get started. First of all, we're going to talk about a Facebook page and Twitter account. We have a Facebook page named ChallengeME. Please like this Facebook page. ChallengeME created social media platforms in order to connect their participants with the team as well as with each other. We're going to update you about the competition deadlines and announcements. So please make sure to like the Facebook page as well as follow us on Twitter and tweet with us using the hashtags IoT, MENA, ChallengeME and Intel. The Intel Twitter is IC_MENA. Now, we're going to move forward to talk about what is ChallengeME, about this competition. ChallengeME is an Internet of Things IoT competition for the Middle East and North Africa that is being organized by Intel Corporation for the first time in the region in collaboration with prestigious educational institutions and nonprofit entrepreneurship organizations across the Middle East and North Africa. The competition aims to recognize and support talented individuals who are building various elements of the Internet of Things and will identify pioneering ideas, innovations, and solutions in the area with great business potential. ChallengeME is looking for a project aimed at developing or using new technology trends within the area of Internet of Things, such as drones, wearable products, smart homes, buildings, cities, future factories, and other. The challenge is open to all IoT enthusiasts who can provide a prototype about their innovation and have a scalable business model. A working prototype is required to be provided before the closing date. So the closing date will be on October 22nd. And of course, the competition is open to everyone above 18 years of old who is resident in the MENA region. Now, what are the three key milestones for the competition? So we have three phases, and we are now in phase one, which is the registration and webinars phase. On the registration and webinar phase, all you need to do is to register to the competition and to fill up the 9 business model canvas and to, of course, submit your prototype. For teams, yes, you can submit as a team. So all teams, get ready. You can also submit as a team. Once you submit your business model as well, you can go and edit your business model anytime before the deadline. So you will notice you have 9 blocks that you need to fill them up. You can edit these 9 blocks anytime you want, and you can submit to the competition as a team as well. This is the second webinar. We're going to have the third webinar on October 7th. Phase number 2 is the shortlisting of the top 15 teams. Between 22 October and October 30, top 15 shortlisted projects will be announced on October 30 and will be provided on the website as well as the social media platforms. Phase 3 is the workshop and award ceremony that's going to take place in Beirut, and we're going to have a final winner. And the top 2 teams will win a paid trip to London to participate at the Intel Innovation Summit and have the opportunity to showcase their projects and network with potential investors. Now, I would like to welcome Mr. Paul. Mr. Paul, can you hear me?
Yes, thanks. Hello.
Mr. Paul from Israel. Yes, Mr. Paul is a biologist by training. He got 8 years of experience and 2 biotech startups and 10 years as software engineer at Intel. Now he's in charge of industrial IoT enabling and startups. Mr. Paul, it's our pleasure to have you with us today. The floor is yours.
Thanks for your good presentation. So today I will make us general presentation about Internet of Things, specifically at Intel, and then we'll see how to develop with tools and hardware some solutions. So first, what is IoT? First, in Internet of Things, there is many definitions, but it has to be highly connected, smart, and it has to be a thing. So if it's not connected, for example, if you are just using a small microcontroller, like, for example, a microwave or something that is doing very smart but is not connected to internet, it's not really Internet of Things. If it's not smart, if it's doing something very simple, usually we call it electronics, but we don't really call it IoT. And it has to be a thing. That's the most difficult part in Internet of Things. We have to resist the urge to create a computer software or a mobile app or something that we use every day. When we are a software developer or an engineer, we have a computer as a tool, and everything we make tends to be like a computer. In IoT, we have to think differently and we have to start from scratch. It has to be a thing. Definitely not a computer, no screen, no interaction. On my fourth point, it has to be an interface between the physical world and internet. So it can have sensors to get a lot of information about temperature, about pollution, about movements, vibrations, all air rate and all kinds of things, but it can also act in the physical world with motors, with sounds and things like that. So the interface between the two worlds is quite important. It has to be highly connected. So when we say Internet of Things, in fact, the connectivity part of the project is not like a typical PC or mobile application. On a PC, on your desktop, you have internet all day long, it works perfectly, and if it doesn't work, you consider that you can't work anymore because you don't have internet. With IoT, it's different. Internet may come and go. For example, if you're trying to build a smart car, perhaps you will have internet when you are in the cities. In the highway, it will work, but sometimes it will drop. And when you will be in a tunnel or in a parking, it will totally drop and you won't have internet at all. So you have to build solutions that can work with intermittent internet access. It has to be low bandwidth, long distance. That's how you can use Sigfox technology, for example, to send your messages with a very short amount of battery usage over a very long distance. It can be a mesh network. A mesh is like a grid where all the items in the grid communicate with their neighbors. On internet, it's not a mesh, it's a star. We are all on the side of internet and we communicate with a big pool of people and there's only one internet. With IoT, you have a lot of small networks that are separated from internet, sometimes connected to internet. So it's really different. And you can use very interesting technologies like Bluetooth Low Energy, ZigBee, and things like that. Then it has to be smart. So to be smart, you have to cross-analyze data from basic sensors to have a good quality information. For example, if I have a watch that is trying to track my health on my physical activity. If I have only one sensor that is my skin temperature, it's good. I can detect some things when you are cycling, for example, because you have the temperature. but you can't differentiate if you have a fever or if you are exercising, because in both cases, you have high temperature. So if you cross-analyze data from temperature and heart rate monitor, on perhaps sedation, on other factors like accelerometer, then you can really detect what is happening and have high quality information. You can balance the smart side of your solution between your card, your IoT solution, and a server. So for example, if you take Google Glasses, they have a small processor in the glasses, but a lot of the analysis is done on the server side on Google data centers. So that's also something to consider, or you want to balance your processing. And it has to be a thing. So just imagine your laptop is a tool that is being designed as an exclusive tool. When you work with your laptop, you do nothing else or nearly nothing else. Perhaps you drink coffee, but that's all. So your laptop is using 90% of your brain and concentration. A mobile phone, it's more like perhaps 40 or 50%. So you can still work, you can talk with people and use your phone, but you can't really walk very fast in the streets, or you will have an accident, and that's even worse in a car. You can't drive safely with a mobile phone. And if you consider IoT solutions, it has to be even lower than that, between 0 and 5%. So a good IoT solution is not something where you will interact a lot with it. It's rather something that will do things without asking your opinion or waiting for your orders. Everything will happen automatically. Because you have one computer, or if you have two, you can only use one at a time. You have one mobile phone. If you are lucky, perhaps you have one tablet on top. But IoT solutions, you will have dozens and hundreds of IoT solutions working for you in your car, at home, at work. So you can't interact with all of them. They have to work by themselves. Okay, so next question is, why deploy IoT solutions? That's a big question. A very typical reason to deploy IoT solution is to optimize. For example, you want to optimize the air conditioning system at work to have a better temperature all day long, the perfect temperature, but also waste less energy or less water. So if you want to optimize things, you have to sense what is the temperature, how many people are in the room, or if they come back to work, perhaps cool or warm the house, perhaps 30 minutes before they arrive. So you have to sense a lot of things and take a lot of smart decisions. That's one way to motivate you to deploy an IoT solutions. For example, if your electricity company is proposing you a deal where you will have 20% cheaper electricity all year, but during 3 days of the summer, when the weather is really, really hot and everybody wants to have air conditioning at full speed, perhaps they will give you only 80% of what you ask in terms of power consumption. So you sacrifice something a few days during the year, but you have cheaper electricity all year around. That's the kind of thing you can do with smart solution that would allow the electricity grid to be more reliable, to accept problems without failings. So there is a lot of good reasons to do that and to be able to do that with smart solutions. And the second reason is not to optimize, but to collect data. So for example, you know probably that a good reason for some companies to build mobile operating systems or even to sell you mobile hardware is very often, in fact, when they do that for free, it's because they want to collect data about you, about your environment. So it's a deal. It's good to know that they are gathering data about us to know if you accept it or not. On IoT solutions will be a lot like that. So very often, it won't be that you will buy an IoT solutions for you as a customer, but usually you will have an IoT solution given for free or perhaps installed for free in your building, and it will do things for you for free. So that's a good thing, but it will also collect data about you and your environment. So it's important to know, to evaluate if it's a good deal for you or not. And as an IoT developer, it's important to design an IoT solution that will focus on this aspect of the business. So let's see a few fields of IoT. First, we have wearable. So we have quantified self. So it's perhaps you know Jawbone or Fitbit that are very famous. At Intel, we have a company that is called Basis that is building very good smartwatches for if you want to monitor your physical activity. And you have WeThings. And perhaps the first one in the history was the Nike plus iPod solution. A very good solution when it was released. A second field is smart watches. So it's a watch, but with a complex screen. It looks like a mobile phone where you have apps and a lot of things like that. So at the bottom, for example, you can see the nice one with stones and wood. That's an Intel design with Intel processor inside. Top right, you have the Motorola that is Android Wear that is quite famous. Of course, you have the Apple Watch. On the pebble in the middle, the black one, for geeks and developers that want to have more control over what is happening with their watch. On the left, you can see the photo of the announcement of the collaboration between Tiger from Switzerland, Intel, and Google. So we are building solutions together, and hopefully you will see that in the market very soon. Very interesting watch. Of course, you know Google Glasses, but Google Glasses are not totally IoT because they behave more or less like a computer. You give them orders, you have the screen in front of you, so it's a very small screen, but that's still a screen. So it looks a little like a mobile device. It's more like a mobile phone than an IoT solution. Then you have a lot of things very interesting happening in the smart building or home automation sector. For example, you have the Nest solution that was bought by Google to optimize your air conditioning, your heating, all your home, and allowing your air conditioning system to be linked to internet, for example, to the power companies. Or a lot of things are possible when you start connecting all your very power-hungry equipment at home with internet. You can optimize a lot of things. A good design is the Sensei Mother, where you have one aggregator in the middle that is very smart, and a lot of what we call edge device at the periphery. So the edge device is only able to connect to the what we call the mother, the aggregator. And the aggregator is smart enough to be connected to internet and to be securely connected to internet. So very often you have different level of devices with edge, aggregator, and internet. So next field is, I wouldn't really call it IoT, but there is a link because the technologies that are used to develop this kind of product are also very close to IoT. So I'm talking about robots and drones that are just flying robots after all. So a very good example is the Nabastag Rabbit. So it's a small robot that was released years ago, and that was pioneering the field of home robotics, I would say. Very interesting design, very smart in terms of interaction with users. I have one at home and I love it. Of course, you have small drones with companies like Parrot, that are more toys, so they can be integrated with your home. It's not only something to work with. And if you talk with professionals that are not very young, that have a few years of experience in this field, they will tell you, yes, but IoT is just a new word for embedded. A lot of things that are happening today are, in fact, old school embedded computing. And that's rather true. For example, we have a design here that was produced by two entrepreneurs from Europe living in Estonia. where you have a computer, but the goal of the object is to make music in parties. So it does not behave like a computer, but there is a computer inside. So in a way, that's IoT. Then you have what we call digital signage in cities. So you have JC Deco and other companies that are very famous for this kind of devices. So they are, in fact, very complex and powerful computers, but they do not behave like computers. You don't see it as a computer. You see it as a screen that is giving you information about the city, because that's what you want in the streets. And the last field of IoT is the best to begin, perhaps not for this contest, but at least to begin experimenting in the field of IoT. I'm talking about developing solution just for the fun, just because you can, without thinking about market, about a product, just for the fun. So in the middle, you have Flower Power from Parrot. It's a solution, very simple, that you can put inside your flower pot, and it will send you a message by email or Twitter when the earth is too dry and you need to add water. So that's a commercial product, you can buy it. On the right, you can see the prototype of this exact same product doing the same thing, but as a prototype. So you can see the wires, and it's not as beautiful, of course, but you have to plug things by yourself. So it started as a joke. So people were developing this project just because it was fun and very simple to code. But Parrot decided that perhaps it could be a good product after all, and now they are selling it. On the left, you have something that is absolutely totally useless. It's a box with an on-off switch at the top of the box. And when you switch on the switch, the box is opening. A little finger is going out of the box and switching off the switch. And that's all it does. And going back in the box. So every time you go and switch on the switch, a little finger will come back immediately and switch off the switch. That's very silly, but that's a very typical way to start in IoT when you just want to learn and have a lot of fun with friends. So now let's talk about electronics and computer boards and prototyping boards, because let's say you are interested, you have some ideas popping in your head, and you would like to start perhaps coding or experimenting. So let's see what you can do with IoT boards from Intel. So before we focus on Intel boards specifically, I would like to talk about the history of the famous prototyping board. So the first one that is really famous and is still extremely famous all over the world is the Arduino board. So the concept of Arduino is to give you something to connect sensors and to code very simple software. So you can't really code a lot of things. You don't have internet access. There is a lot of things that you don't have. It's not a computer. It's a microcontroller. You have to understand that microcontrollers and processors are totally different things. A microcontroller may cost perhaps 50 cents or even 10 cents or 1 euro. It's very cheap, very simple, where a processor will cost perhaps 10, 100 or 1,000 euros and can do a lot more. You can have an operating system like Linux, Windows, or something else on top of it. You will have internet access, a lot of software, and a lot of freedom. So when you start prototyping on IoT, you have to ask yourself, do I need something with a microcontroller, or do I need something with a processor? So Arduino is a microcontroller-based solution. That's very simple. So if you don't like coding, or if you want to start very slow and not focus too much on coding first, then Arduino is perfect. That's why it is so famous, because it's easy to start with. So the good thing is that you can plug resistors and LEDs and cables and everything. So you can really experiment. You don't need to solder things or do very complex setup. You can just plug everything with your fingers. A second very famous board is the Raspberry Pi. So this one is not a microcontroller-based board, it's a processor-based board. So it happens that the processor that is on the Raspberry Pi is not from Intel, it's from ARM. But that just we have a more in common with other processor manufacturers than with a regular microcontroller. And to make things a little more complex at Intel, we are famous for building powerful processors, but right now we are releasing a lot of very small and tiny processors that do very simple things with a very, very, very low power that look like microcontrollers. And in the next month, we will release things, products that are microcontroller based. So the clear separation between microcontrollers and processor is disappearing, at least for Intel, because we are proposing a line of products that is, in fact, doing both. So Raspberry Pi, not Intel-based, very cheap, not very fast. So I wouldn't use it as a computer, for example. But if you want something cheap to connect a few sensors or perhaps a screen because you have a graphic screen, that's good for prototyping. So, of course, this kind of board you see is smaller than a computer, but it's not something you can have in your pocket, for example. It is still a board. So it's good for prototyping, but you can't really go in production with a board like that. It's a bit too big. Now let's focus on how to compare IoT boards. So I talked a lot about microcontroller versus processor. That's a very important criteria to understand, because if it's very cheap, like $5, for example, well, it probably won't be very powerful either. So it makes sense. If it's cheap, it's usually less powerful than it's expensive. So if it's $5 or $50, it's probably not the same power. That's okay. You have to keep that in mind. Then the second criteria is to understand what kind of I/O input output you have on your board. So if you have a PC, you know that you are looking for USB, for HDMI, stuff like that. So you know how to analyze I/O when you buy a computer and you know what you want. For IoT boards, you connect sensors and motors and things like that. And they basically fall into two categories, digital or analog. And when you have a digital I/O, you can go higher in complexity and have protocols on top of digital that are called I2C, SPI, and things like that. So I don't want to give you too much details, but just keep in mind that a lot of sensors are using analog. So you want a board with analog I/O to connect sensors. And a lot of things like motors, for example, use digital. So if you want to both have sensors and motors, you need both digital and analog I/O. That's the case for the Intel boards we'll see. That's also the case for Arduino. Usually Raspberry Pi is only proposing digital, so it depends what you want to do. Find the best solution for your problem. Another important point is the presence of a graphics chip inside the board. So remember that we are not trying to build a computer with a screen that will interact with you. We are trying to build IoT solutions. So instead of having one or two devices at home, like you have one or two computers perhaps, you will have dozens, hundreds of IoT solutions in the future. So, and you don't want to have dozens or hundreds of screens. You don't want one big screen on your fridge and one big screen on your microwave and one big screen on every piece of furniture in your kitchen, for example. So if you start asking for a graphics chip inside an IoT board, keep in mind that perhaps you are not really doing an IoT solution. Be careful. That's why at Intel, we split the boards between the mobile and embedded boards that always have graphics and the IoT boards that never have graphics. That's a very clear for us separation. different usage models, and networking. So, of course, you can always plug, for example, Ethernet USB adapter. You can always plug adapters for networking. You can plug a Wi-Fi adapter. You can plug a 3G adapter on a Raspberry Pi, on a PC, on a lot of things. But if you plug things, your solution is getting bigger. It's also getting more expensive because each adapter is perhaps $15 or $30. So it's getting expensive pretty quickly. And it's not really nice. You have to find drivers, so it's complex. If you can find an IoT board with wireless built-in, it's a lot easier. It's like a laptop or mobile phone. If I tell you, okay, I give you a very good mobile phone, cheap, very powerful, but you will have to plug the Wi-Fi on the 3G connection yourself because it's an option, you will probably answer, but this is useless. I want integrated wireless. And for IoT, that's the same thing. So keep in mind that networking is important. And the next criteria is form factor. So we've seen that the Raspberry Pi, for example, or Arduino are great boards, but they are big, I would say, because you want them to be big to plug things with your fingers very easily. So it's convenient. It is designed to be convenient, to be rather large. But if you want to build a very small product and to sell it, you don't want something big. You really want something very small. So the size of the board is also something you have to consider, depending on what you want to do. And the next point is about going to production. So a lot of the commercial IoT developers we meet in the field are very happy about prototyping. So they know how to work with Arduino, Raspberry Pi, or Intel boards, and they can build very good prototypes. But at some point they say, okay, I have a very good prototype. Now I want to create my company. I want to sell a product or a service. And I just need to transfer my prototype on to make it a product. So it sounds easy to say, but it's really difficult to do if you haven't picked the right prototyping boards. Some prototyping boards are designed for prototyping only, and that's perfect. Like that, if you know that you are only planning prototyping. Some other boards from Intel or competition are designed to be great for prototyping, but also great for production. So what's the difference? Well, it's a matter of size. It's a matter of power optimization. It's a matter of intellectual property. There is a lot of things. So very often when we talk with developers, they ask about OS. So if you want to build one solution, usually you can take, one product, one item, you can use any OS you want. It can be a Mac, Windows, Ubuntu, Linux, whatever. Usually, if you're just trying to build one at home, it's okay. You can always find a way. But if you're trying to build 10 million units of your product, and 10 million units will be distributed all over the world, maintenance is getting difficult, like mobile phones, for example. You usually notice that they get updated automatically. They do everything by themselves, and it works. And to make it work, you need an OS that is capable of doing that at a very large scale, a professional-grade operating system. So a very typical solution in this field is called Yocto. It's an open-source operating system. And if you want something more commercial, great, you can use Wind River, that is part of Intel. So for example, if you take the rover that is rolling on Mars and taking pictures and analyzing soil, it is a very complex robot with a plutonium core generating electricity and stuff like that. And it's running Wind River because they needed the quality and extended support and everything that goes with Wind River. Because the rover is on Mars, so if you need to reinstall the operating system, You have to do it over wireless between Earth and Mars. And if it fails, you can't send someone to reboot the machine and reinstall the operating system. So it has to work perfectly. That's sometimes why you need OSs like Winrever. Okay, now let's talk about hardware, the fun part, because we are a hardware company. So 2 years ago, we released something called Intel Galileo. So you notice that it looks a lot like an Arduino board. You have black pins at the top and bottom, but you have a processor in the middle, an Intel processor. So it behaves like an Arduino board, and it's an official collaboration with the Arduino Foundation. But it behaves also like a Linux PC over the network. So it's a bit of both. It was good for prototyping, not for production. We distributed 50,000 boards in universities worldwide, so a lot of students are learning IoT development with Galileo. Then last year, we released Edison. So Edison is the small board that you see in the free photo, the teal colored board. Under the Edison, you have some red or blue boards of different shapes. So the concept of Edison is that you have a small computer that has everything included. So you have a processor, memory, storage, Wi-Fi, Bluetooth, tons of things in a very small package, and you can plug this package on an extension board where you have a lot of pins to plug things with your fingers, or a small board like the red ones. So you can plug the very complex parts on a very simple extension board. So that's what we call a modular design, and that's fantastic if you want to go from prototyping to production. And this year we announced Curie, so it will be released on the market before the end of the year. So you see it's very small, so it's not as powerful as Edison, but it will also be cheaper. And it's when you need less computing power and also less connectivity, because you don't have Wi-Fi, you have Bluetooth low energy. So typically in a lot of solutions, you would have a lot of Curie, for example, at home, in your furniture, in your clothes, and everything. A lot of Curie would be connected to one Edison, and Edison would be connected with Wi-Fi to your set-top box to have internet access. So you see, you have different boards, and the answer is not, I want only this board. Usually the answer is, okay, I want to plug this board with this other board, and I want to connect Edison with an internet data processing system on a server. Usually it's about having solution interacting with each other rather than saying, okay, I just want one microcontroller, or I want one processor. Usually you need a bit of everything. So that was for the IoT solutions we have on the market this year. But we also have things that are not specifically IoT, but are really useful for embedded, for example, design, for digital signage and things like that. So on the right, you have a HDMI compute stick. So you can see the HDMI port at the top. It's something you plug on your TV, and you have a small computer that is rather powerful. You can run a Linux or Windows 10. You have Wi-Fi and everything. So it's a small computer you can plug on your TV. If you want something more robust and more powerful, we have the gray box in the middle called the Next Unique Computing. And this is very successful with people that require a small PC, very simple, with full control over the PC for industrial designs. So you can buy one for prototyping, or you can buy 1,000, 100,000. You will always find the right quantity for your project. That's really good to know. On every 6 months or every year, we release a new version of the NUC with new features. So it's really a good design for a lot of projects. So I will go fast on the specification, because that's not the most interesting part. You can see that online. Of course, it's all public. So Galileo is what we call a system on chip. So it's not really a processor. It is more than a processor. It's a processor with memory management and a few things like that. And it's called Intel Quark. It's 32 bits and it's running at 400 megahertz. In terms of I/O, you have mini PCI Express, Ethernet, micro SD slots, serial port, USB host, USB client, and Arduino compatible pins. You can run a lot of different operating systems on it. By default, it's Linux Yocto, so it's open source. You can have some form of Debian variant. You can also install Windows 10 sometimes on the professional grade solutions like Winriver if you want to test and learn about Winriver. Now, let's focus on Edison. So on Edison, you have two processors with two operating systems. The one by default that you see when you are connected on Edison is an Atom processor running at 500 megahertz with a typical Linux Yocto. Then you have a second processor that is very small that works like a microcontroller and is called Intel Quark. So it's 32 bits running at 100 megahertz and it's running a real-time operating system called Viper. So that's you usually don't see the Quark part unless you really need it and unless you understand why you need it. So it's mostly for people that are curious or embedded specialists. You have 1 gigabit of memory embedded, 4 gigabytes of storage in Edison, Wi-Fi and Bluetooth, including Bluetooth for low energy. And that's a very important point because there's a lot of wonderful stuff you can do on IoT with this Bluetooth 4. If you don't know Bluetooth 4, do not imagine it is like Bluetooth you have on your cell phone that is eating your battery very fast when you connect an headset. Bluetooth 4 is totally different. It is wonderful in terms of features, in terms of power saving. It's a wonderful technology and it's a standard in the industry. So you can interact between Intel and tons of other devices very quickly. It's really a wonderful technology. For example, between Edison and Curie. But if you replace Curie with something else, it will also work as long as it's Bluetooth 4. In terms of I/O, you have 40 GPIOs. So you have SD card, UART, I2C, SPI, LAP, etc. So you can see the spec online, no problem, it's public. So that was all for this presentation. Thank you very much. And I think we have a Q&A session or we can read questions probably from the terminal that we have on the right.
Thank you, so, Mr. Paul. Can you please reply to the questions in the chat box?
Yes. So from Tamer, can a sensor be a camera? Yes, the easy way to connect a camera is to have a very cheap, very simple USB camera. For example, you can go on website where you can buy them for $3, something like that, and it will be a very simple sensor. If you take a very expensive camera, perhaps you will need some drivers to make it work. If you have drivers for Linux, it's great. But if you don't have drivers for Linux for your camera, there is a lot of cameras without drivers for Linux, you won't be able to use it. We also have some 3D cameras that we call perceptual computing or RealSense now that you can potentially plug on Edison or on a PC. And it's acting as a sensor. So question, what if my IoT interacts with people? So you can, if it makes sense for your IoT solution, it's great. Just keep in mind that today people don't really have a lot of IoT solutions. So if you ask people to interact with you, perhaps they will have time for you. But very soon people will have a lot of IoT solutions and they will prefer to have solutions that work perhaps not perfectly, but work autonomously without asking them for their opinion or advice or orders. So what if it is an app that helps build Internet of Things project? You may, but I think the spirit of the contest is really to focus on IoT. So there is already a lot of stuff happening on the mobile space, including in relation with IoT. For example, if you want to develop IoT solutions, at Intel, we have what we call the SDK. So you can go on our website and have all the documentation and explanations about how it works. SDK, that is based on Eclipse. And we have another SDK that is called the XDK, where you can develop solutions using JavaScript. So it's a little more... It's easier if you like JavaScript. And we have a third solution that is called WillyAdrin. That is very simple. You can build your solution with only the mouse by pushing buttons and plugging them together. So that's the kind of app that you can use from a mobile phone to build IoT solutions. So I would rather focus on building IoT solutions themselves, because that's something new and that's something that most people don't know how to do. So it's a good opportunity to learn. Okay, question from Dara. I do not deal with hardware, but develop my applications. How can I participate in this range? So my advice to everybody is to get in each team someone that knows about software and someone that knows a little about Linux or embedded or this kind of server development. And if possible, someone that knows or can do stuff with hardware. For example, at home, I'm a software guy. So I'm not really good at electronics, not really good at hardware, but I found ways to make things that work that are quite simple, even if I'm not a specialist. For example, I work a lot with wood because it's cheap and you can create a lot of things. Not very nice thing, but a lot of things with wood. You can drill holes, you can cut with very cheap equipment. So even if you don't know how to do 3D printing, or you don't have the equipment or stuff like that, it's not really important. You can really keep it simple, but I would definitely encourage you to work together with different kind of competencies. So my advice would be one that knows about business or at least has ideas about how to make or to propose IoT solutions that make sense from a business point of view. It's always better if it makes sense. Someone that knows about software, definitely. And if possible, someone that knows about hardware or Linux or level. Ah, good question. Is ROS supported? So yes, ROS is a robotic operating system, and you can install ROS on top of a lot of OSs. And I know that some people documented how to install ROS on Edison. Sometimes I use Yocto, sometimes I use another Linux that is called Ubilinux. But if you type on internet ROS on Edison, you will definitely find some people working with that. So next, we have very interesting questions for the organization. For example, is it limited to Intel hardware? How many people can participate in a team? So I will let potential answer regarding the term and conditions of the contest.
Yes, Mr. Poole, thank you. There is no limited number for team members, but the team members who can register through the website are three, and two will be, if they were chosen between the shortlisted top 15, two will have the opportunity to travel to Lebanon. So there is no limited team members in the team, but according to the system, you can add only two team members. So three, one, you can add two members to your team.
So I see a technical question. Do we have at Intel 64-bit embedded system? Yes, we have a lot of that. Usually you don't really need a lot of 64-bit in small embedded systems because 64-bit is only interesting when you have a lot of memory. If you don't use a lot of memory and 64-bit is not going to help. It may even hurt your performance just a little. But to answer your questions, yes, we have a lot of servers, for example, that are very small, very compact, that are designed for very high performance processing. For example, video encoding in a very specific embedded setups. So yes, we have a lot of 64-bit embedded solutions.
Do you have any other questions for Mr. Poole? The deadline for submissions is on the 22nd of October. Do you have any other questions for Mr. Poole?
Okay, technical question from Tamer. Where can we locate the emulator for Edison boards? So there is no emulator because Edison is in fact a Linux PC with an Atom board. So just imagine that you have a small laptop with Atom processor, what we call netbook, or a small laptop that you can buy for like $200. The processor that you have inside on the Linux that you have on top of it is exactly the same on Edison on this laptop. So you don't need an emulator. You can just develop on your PC with Linux, and you can even compile on your PC and move your binary to Edison if you respect the libraries, but it's the same CPU architecture, so you don't need to emulate. And so that's a good thing. You, even if you don't have the hardware in your country or close to you, you can still develop a lot of things without Edison, or perhaps if you plan to receive Edison later, to do it on your PC first. For example, I would highly recommend programming with a Node.js. That's something that is very typical in IoT that is supported by Intel. We support all languages, but Node.js is very typical. You can develop on your Mac, on your Windows, on Linux, on anything. Start coding, and when you are happy, you can move to Edison. Or you can even work with the SDK that I talked about a few minutes ago, the Eclipse SDK, the XDK. So they are not emulating Edison, but you can start coding and check your code and start your project.
Thank you, Mr. Poole. Any other questions? Any other questions, guys?
Okay, so that seems to be all for the technical questions. Thanks a lot for your time on your interesting question on IoT, and I wish you the best. Really go on software.intel.com/IoT to get the SDK, to get training, documentation on everything. This is really how you can start coding. And all the software are free, so no problem.
Thank you, Mr. Poole, for your time and for your great effort. It was a pleasure having you with us tonight.
Thank you. Bye-bye. Au revoir.
Au revoir. Okay, guys, please note that our next webinar will be held on October 7. We'll be discussing the submission process as well as the business model canvas. So any questions about the business model canvas, get it ready. If you have any questions, I will share with you now the email that you can email us on this email, and we can answer any of your questions. Please note that this session will be available in the resource section on the website, as well as we're going to send it for you as an email. And before I will leave, the quote is, the value of an idea lies in the using of it. I had a question. I want to join the competition in 2016. Well, Intel every year is preparing a competition. So hopefully we might have the competition as well in 2016 or any other type of competitions. Please don't forget to submit your business model and prototype before 22 October. Now, please, can you rate this session? Before you leave, please answer the poll questions to help us improve this program. I would love to thank you all for your interaction tonight, all your questions. Thank you for being here. We are waiting your projects. So let's start with the first question. How do you rate the content of the session? For more questions, please don't hesitate to email us. We are ready to help. How do you rate the main presenter of this session? Don't forget to join our next webinar on October 2nd, 7-9. Visit the resources section on the challengeme.intel.com website. Okay, you can start creating team anytime you want. All you need to do is to enter to your dashboard and you scroll down, you will notice the word members, you enter their email address. You can enter two email addresses for your two team members. The presentation of the project will be on the resources section and we're gonna email you the records, don't worry. No, you can submit only one project per person. The old webinar and this webinar will be on the resources section. We have already placed the old webinar there. It talked about the business model canvas. No, it won't affect the evaluation. I advise you to go into the 9 business model canvas and see if you can easily fill it up. If not, collect your questions and we will be ready to answer in the next session. We are here to help. Work hard on your prototypes and let us know if you have any question in the next session as well. Thank you. Thanks a lot, guys. It was a pleasure talking to you and answering your questions. Don't hesitate to email us and we're ready to help. See you online on next session, October 7. Thank you, guys, and work hard. Have a great evening, everyone.